he does, I'll be there. Don't you know, baby? Yeah, yeah,
I'll be there. I'll be there. Just call my name. I'll be there.
Just look over your shoulders, honey.
Hello, everybody. Welcome. My name is Kimberly McDonald, and I'm the Senior Manager of Academic Programs for Design at CCA. Before we get started, I'd like to quickly go over some logistics. First, I'd like to show you where the Q&A feature is located at the bottom of your screen. Please use this feature to ask your questions. We may not be able to get to them all, so please be sure to upvote any questions you'd like answered first. Additionally, closed captioning is available during the webinar. Next to Q&A, you should see a button that says Live Transcript. Click the up arrow to show subtitles, open a full transcript, or edit the size of your subtitles. If you have any trouble with this feature, please use the chat and someone on our staff can help you out. Finally, Nina, the program manager for MDES, will be putting our community agreement into the chat. Please take a moment to read it over before we begin, and now I'll hand it over to Helen Maria Nugent. Thank you.
Thank you, Kimberly. Thank you, Nina. Good evening, good morning, good afternoon, everyone, wherever you are. I'm Helen Maria Nugent. I'm the Dean of Design here at California College of the Arts. Thanks for joining us tonight for Margot Bloomstein, the final event in our spring lecture series. Design at CCA is a sanctuary for those with radical curiosity, a place where wonder and imagination are amplified through rigorous experimentation and deep craft. Our purpose is to equip makers, thinkers, and doers with the wherewithal to envision alternate futures and the creative capacity to deliver generative solutions and inspire change. In partnership with our colleagues in fine arts, design, and architecture, and the humanities, we make art and design that matters. As you can see on the screen, we are 9 programs in total, 6 undergraduate programs and 3 graduate programs, including our host for this evening, the Masters of Design in Interaction Design. Our campuses are located in Huichin and Yelamu, also known as Oakland and San Francisco, respectively, on the unceded territories of the Chochenyo and Ramayatush Ohlone peoples, who have continuously lived upon this land since time immemorial. CCA honors Indigenous peoples, past, present, and future, here and around the world, and we wish to pay respect to our local elders with this land acknowledgement. I'd also like to say just really briefly how horrified I am and others are by the elevated racial violence and the recent hate crimes inflicted on our friends, families, colleagues, and neighbors. I want all of the members of our community, our Asian American and Asian American students, faculty, and staff to know that we stand with you and we're in support and in solidarity. As you can see on the screen here, our speakers this semester have been leading practitioners whose work is reshaping our world. I want to invite you all, especially the CCA community, to return to these critical conversations at any time. Recordings will be available on the CCA portal. We will put a link in the chat. And I want to give a big thanks to CCA faculty Sarah Leah Fortis and Sasha Charlemagne for writing exquisite synopsis of each lecture this semester. And a final heartfelt thanks to our Chilean graphic designer, Alejandra Valenzuela, who's a graduate of our MFA design program. And she created all of the graphics and the identity pieces that you're seeing for this series. She calls the concept the electricity of the idea, rays, dots, stitches, representing all sensations and connections generated when creating. And thanks lastly again to Kimberly for all her work this semester and Nina for helping us put this together for this evening. Could Josh and Margot please turn on your videos? Hi, out there in space.
Hello.
It's really, really great to have you both here. So tonight's program is sponsored by the Masters of Design and Interaction Design program. And Josh Silverman, who you see right here, is our chair of that program. In addition to this role, of course, it's a very important role. He speaks and hosts workshops globally, teaches and guest critiques nationally, and is always connecting people and communities, which I think you're definitely going to hear more about in a minute or two. He consults in brand, product and design operations and coaches founders and design leaders. Previously, he advised startups, inside Sequoia Design Lab, served as Twitter's first hire in design operations, and was one of the founding designers of the IBM Cloud Guide. So I'm going to hand it over to you, Josh. I know you're going to introduce Margot. I'm really excited for your lecture tonight, and I hope you all enjoy this evening's programming.
Thank you, Helen Maria. That was amazing. And yes, I have the pleasure of introducing Margot. Margot is one of the leading voices in the content strategy universe. Margot identifies as a designer of content. She is the author of Trustworthy, How the Smartest Brands Beat Cynicism and Bridge the Trust Gap. And she's also the author of Content Strategy at Work, Real World Stories to Strengthen Every Interactive Project. She's also the principal of Appropriate Inc., a brand and content strategy consultancy located in Boston. As a speaker and strategic advisor, she has worked with marketing teams in a range of organizations over the past two decades. She has also developed Brand Sort, a nifty tool to help clients engage in the process of prioritizing their message architecture. Tonight, I used it as a tarot deck, and the word that I chose for tonight was slick. Yes, Margot also teaches at the Content Strategy Graduate Program at FH Johannium University in Graz, Austria, lectures around the world about brand-driven content strategy and designing for trust. Everyone, please welcome back to CCA, Margot Bloomstein.
Thank you so much. I am thrilled to be here, thrilled for the opportunity to take part in the spring lecture series and really to share the ideas that we'll be discussing tonight with all of you. I think one of the recurring themes when I've gotten to talk about Trustworthy and in talking with colleagues as I was working on the book was that I couldn't wait to get these ideas, to get this new framework out into the hands of people that could run with them, out into the hands of designers and writers and artists and people that work in professional communications, people that are marketers and social media consultants, because I felt that where we are now in society, a lot of people feel discouraged and disenfranchised and cynical. And I think that we are all, everyone kind of joining in tonight, we are all perfectly positioned to do something about that. So that's what I want to focus on over the next half hour or so, and then dig into questions around it and hear what you all think. So let me go ahead and jump into sharing there. So I want to just start by saying, I am here and you are here because, as I said, things are tough right now. A lot of people feel pretty cynical about the world. And I think also because our users, our audiences don't necessarily trust us. I recognize that as a designer. I recognize that as somebody that's a consultant and a content strategist. And the thing is, I don't trust you. And you probably don't trust me either because I haven't given you any reasons yet to. And I think that's true for most people. Most of us don't trust what we hear. And I think that is especially important now because in retail, in government, in public health, in software, in financial services, you've probably noticed how a lot of marketing is falling flat, even when it's marketing that is designed to help people help themselves. And sales cycles are taking longer and most messages don't motivate action. And that isn't just because of the pandemic. of course, the pandemic has affected the economy in enormous ways, but also people just don't trust brands the way they used to. They don't trust those traditional sources of expertise the way they used to. But I don't think we can blame them either, because as we look around, we, people in our audiences, the users that we serve, we've endured failures of leadership, deception from the halls of government and maybe from news sources that we used to trust, and inconsistent messaging from brands that we thought that we knew. And when people don't know who to trust, when they decide not to believe anything, that's when they grow cynical. And that's a problem, because in this age of fake news and hidden agendas, cynicism can feel safe. People turn away from experts. Maybe they take refuge in their own filter bubbles and then become more aware of those filter bubbles and how they're shaped by algorithms. So then they tend to turn inward. We get that mindset of like, well, you can't trust anything, so I'm just going to go with my gut. But that's where we see even bigger problems, because when people start to go down that path, that's also when they start to distrust their own gut instincts. When they lose confidence in their own ability to make good decisions, they stop making decisions. And I think that's where we can help. That's where we can meet people on that kind of ground. And to regain our audiences, to rebuild their sense of confidence, their sense of self-confidence, and to even foster their sense of trust again, we need to empower them to make good decisions. We need to meet them where they are and affirm their hope, their interest in learning, their enthusiasm for feeling knowledgeable. That's something that people still share. That's something that we still have in common. And I think that is the work of designers. That is the work of people in professional communications, whether it's visual or verbal. And that is not a new problem. This is not a new challenge. And we already have the tools to address it. So I wanna take us back. So pre-pandemic, pre the dot-com era, I wanna actually take us back a few centuries. So let's go back to commerce in pre-Renaissance Europe. That's where I think we can find some very relevant lessons. So if you'll allow me, let's go on to the Wayback Machine. So the stuff that we struggle with around trust and communication, that's stuff that people in the 1500s struggled with as well. And then the need for information, for trustworthy information, it was starting to change, because previously people who sold goods, maybe candles or cloth or salt, they would do so by hauling their wares from town to town in a region, maybe to markets and fairs. But in the Renaissance, trading families started to grow. These empires began to grow that realized that they could actually reap greater profits, not by going to all those little markets, but rather by staying put and engaging in arbitrage among multiple cities and countries. The catch in that kind of economy, though, the thing that made it work, was that those trading merchants needed information that they could trust about those different cities. So that brings us to this guy. And I know you can see like those scraps of paper there on the wall behind him. They're clearly early post-it notes. He was our first example of an information architect. No, he's not. He's not an IA. This is actually George Keyes, and he was a Renaissance era trading merchant. Those scraps of paper on the wall there behind him, those are letters that he's pinned up. And he represents this sort of emerging merchant class who ran export and import businesses across all of Europe. And those letters that he has behind him, they represent letters from the people that he employed. So that kind of work took specialized knowledge about the cities in which he wanted to operate. And to make good decisions, he would employ people that lived in those different cities to write him these periodic updates, to write him periodic letters about the economic conditions. Maybe it was about like the palace intrigue, or if there was talk of going to war, or what competitors might be doing. And he would grow to kind of understand their tone of voice, if they typically would write in a heightened state of angst and anxiety, or if they were a little bit more even keel. And those letter writers, those foreign correspondents, they were effectively the first journalists. And they would empower merchants by developing that kind of familiar tone over time, by offering a consistent level of detail, as well as a unique perspective. They held themselves open to new information. They were vulnerable to new information. So that in one letter, they might say, you know, there's talk of war. We're definitely going to be going to war with France. Maybe hold back on sending more fine silks and fabrics and whatnot here. And then in the next letter, they can say, hey, you know, we got some new information. I heard better information. We are not going to war. So move ahead with sending us more silk. It was that kind of information to which they were vulnerable. They held themselves open to new ideas so that they could grow their knowledge and it would evolve over time. And then the people to whom they were writing, those different merchants, their knowledge could grow over time too. Those were the people that were benefiting most from that level of information. So those letter writers offered authority and consistency. And that's what we still value today, because that's what empowers us too. That's what empowers our audiences too, to make better choices about what we buy, how we maintain our health, where we shop, maybe even how we vote. And that idea of authority is important, because those letter writers, those foreign correspondents and journalists, they established authority by sharing that unique perspective with the right depth of detail and context, and then sharing how their knowledge was consistently and constantly growing. So you can think of that as a unique voice, the right volume of detail, and a sort of strength through vulnerability. Now, authority comes from being willing to go where your audience cannot, maybe because of the danger or the cost or the depth of expertise. And that's why when Anderson Cooper talks to us from a war-torn region, we sit up and listen. We trust his authority. When David Chang, the owner and the chef of the Momofuku chain and now the star of Ugly Delicious, which is definitely good television, when he takes us to explore crawfish or Asian Cajun fusion food, we stop and listen. We trust his authority. We trust his depth of expertise. When NPR's Ophabia Quist-Arkton sits down and talks to us live from Dakar, or when she sat down with Anthony Bourdain to talk about Senegalese food, we listen to both of them because we trust their respective authority, their unique viewpoints, as well as their depth of knowledge and their willingness to kind of go on a personal journey and engage in new experiences and maybe correct their own misconceptions along the way. That they're willing to take us along on that personal journey says a lot about their respect for the audience, as well as how their audience respects them. That idea of authority plays out even if you work in marketing, even if you're an in-house designer. You have specialized knowledge that your audience does not. And when you empower them with that knowledge, that's how you empower them to make better decisions. Now, this idea of authority, it empowers, it educates, it respects us, it respects the audience, because for each of those people that I mentioned, they don't speak down, they're not condescending, they're also not gaslighting their audience. They're not saying, I am your only source of information. Don't trust the evidence of your own experiences or the evidence of your own eyes, just turn to me. They're not doing any of that. They're not demanding absolute loyalty. And as a result, their audience grows in confidence. And then they reward that kind of shared confidence in trust. I've been reading a lot from Jay Rosen, the press critic, about authority. And I think that we can bring some of his thinking into our own work, because when people or institutions or brands have authority, maybe on more than just their product array, maybe on an industry as a whole, we reward it in trust. When they give us information that is relevant to our own needs, when we see our values reflected back in their values and actions, again, we reward that in trust. But when a brand starts to break from what we know, maybe what we trust about their voice or their subject matter, it can be hard to reconcile that. It can be hard to come to terms with it. And similarly, if you don't provide your audience with content that meets their needs in length or in level of detail, that's when they start to fall away, because you're no longer trustworthy. You're no longer relevant. And issues of trust and consistency and irrelevance, that's what stokes our cynicism. And today, those issues add up in major ways across all industries, where we see how people suffer a crisis of trust. And this might have been something that started in the political arena several years ago, or in how media and was covering politicians or not. but now it affects every industry where there are consumers or citizens or readers or shoppers. We used to place trust in familiar brands and established media. Maybe they were the brands that you grew up with because they reflected our reality. But we don't trust those same institutions anymore because they've been inconsistent with what they promise or how they speak to us or what they claim. And those creeping inconsistencies are a sneaky thing. And we look around and we say, well, you can't trust anything. Everybody's out to get you. All politicians lie. And like us, our users now look at the world with more skepticism than with trust. The problem is when that skepticism becomes a greater degree of cynicism, and it holds them back from making decisions, when it holds them back from doing research to become smarter. That's a problem. That's what we need to address. Because when institutions tell us not to trust the evidence of our own eyes, that's the problem too. That's gaslighting. It affects our very ability to trust in both other brands and ourselves, in our own perceptions. People don't trust their own judgment anymore. This is a big problem in the US as well as in other countries. This is no longer just our problem. It's now become an American export. And that kind of insidious cynicism, as I said, it undermines all institutions, every institution or industry where we can make a contribution. And I think if you're in UX or design or interaction design or any kind of area of communications, you know that this undermines your work. It does undermine our work, but I think we're also very well positioned to address it too. So this is kind of the secret, sort of the problem statement for the future of our work. To regain the trust of people, we must empower our audiences. And if you work in marketing or content or design, you already have the tools to do that. Whether your users are consumers or citizens or donors or voters, to regain their trust, we need to empower them, to help them make good decisions. And by educating them and rebuilding their confidence in themselves, that's how we regain their trust in the organizations that we represent, as well as their trust in society as a whole. Because this is about more than just fixing maybe the relationships within and beyond the companies where we work. This is about more than just fixing a single industry. This is about really fixing and fueling our society to progress. And I think we have the tools to do that. So this gets us back to that idea of authority, because marketing, as I said, is a form of authority. It's saying, I'm here, you're not, let me tell you about it. And brands that can teach us about their product category, that comes from a position of authority. Product descriptions speak from a position of authority. Brands that put a stake in the ground to share their values and make their values visible, that is a form of authority that serves as a beacon to other institutions to say, hey, this issue, this social issue matters. If it matters in the communities that we want to serve, the communities where we want to do business, we should be getting involved in those issues. Now that takes vulnerability. We're going to be talking about that a lot in a bit. But that's not vulnerability that we should make synonymous with weakness. It's vulnerability that speaks from a position of strength. And yeah, we're in a difficult position right now. I think that the erosion of trust is crippling every industry that attempts to sell products, offer services, help people help themselves, or attempts to inform or persuade. We see how this affects public health communications, certainly around vaccination and issues like that. But I think there is hope. And that hope starts by empowering our audiences. Because if people are looking inward for answers, we should be meeting them there. So to regain your audience's trust, empower them with useful, usable information. And that has three components. It's voice, volume, and vulnerability. And those are the same tools that those Renaissance era letter writers used so well. So by voice, I mean the distinct personality that manifests both visually and verbally in everything an organization does across all of its different platforms and touch points and print collateral. So do you project a sense of tradition or innovation? Are you maybe more witty and polished or more scrappy and creative? It's your brand's voice that helps your audience distinguish it from your competitors. but it also helps to humanize your brand and elevate what you think is most important. It tells your audience who you are and how you are, and if you're someone that they can trust. But when a brand changes over time, maybe to pursue new offerings or because it's just time to overhaul the website when you want to change the voice, that's when you run the risk of alienating your audience because suddenly they don't know who you are. And I think though, by using a consistent voice to expose those changes, to let people know what's coming in plain language, maybe to expose the roadmap, that's how users maintain confidence, not just in the brand, but also in their own knowledge of where it's going. One of my favorite examples of that comes from MailChimp, the email marketing company, and they've helped their voice evolve a lot over time. Now, I call them an email marketing company because that's how they started out. They were a small business serving other small businesses. Growth is not without its challenges, though, and sometimes culture needs guidelines in order to scale. Brands need guidelines in order to scale. Now, early on, Freddie, their mascot, he would serve up copy and appear throughout the platform, and you'd hear error messages in his tone of voice. And that was fine when they were just another small business. But they're no longer a small business. Now it's something like more than 60% of the world's email marketing goes through MailChimp. They also do way more than just email marketing. Now they're also in the e-commerce game. But they've never wanted to abandon their legacy customers or abandon their legacy services. So as they've grown over time, they've mapped out a strategy to maintain certain aspects of the brand. The copy remains in the first person, but now the tone is more robust. They've developed guidelines to vary it for different audiences so that people do know what to expect if they're maybe coming from another marketing platform or if they're a more experienced marketer. Or if there's somebody that's totally new to all of this and they need all the jargon broken down in a way that they can understand. They've also done a lot to help their illustration style evolve over time, to expand it, to include photography, and to offer the same level of detail, the same level of abstraction in all of their images. The result of doing that, the result of creating those sort of style guidelines and guardrails that allow the brand to evolve, is that it better serves their audience. It also better serves their internal content creators and the freelancers that they use. So they're giving them guidelines to say, here is how to vary it so that our tone is not necessarily monolithic and consistent, but it's cohesive. All the parts go together and all the parts go back to the whole. And in doing that, they've given their audience a way to understand and interact with them and know what to expect wherever they encounter the brand. And then they've also given all of their content creators and illustrators and photographers and copywriters ways to manifest the brand that are flexible and broad enough to meet their needs across different campaigns and different target audiences. So if your brand's voice addresses how you communicate visually and verbally, volume refers to how much you communicate in both length and level of detail, how much you need to say on a topic, how long should a blog post be, how many images need to be in a photo gallery to tell a complete story. Should your images be incredibly detailed and nuanced, or do you want to take more of like a simple, clean approach, very, very IKEA-esque? It's those types of questions that help your brand figure out how you relate to your audience in a way that empowers them to make good decisions. Because we know that brevity and bullets have ceded space to long form content online, even on e-commerce sites. But it's still not an opportunity or an excuse to just babble. We still need to figure out, well, how much content, whether that is copy or the level of detail in an image, is enough. And the answer for that can come through in user research. When people are able to say, yeah, this felt good, and you know you've offered enough detail, when the audience says that, yeah, it feels good, and they can make good decisions and then feel good about the decisions they make. We can measure that through the rate of product returns and time on site and the number of times they have to go back and go through an exercise again and again to make sure they did it right. When we can minimize those types of things, when we can minimize the rate of product returns, that's a result that we can measure maybe in across different aspects of the bottom line of the brand, but it all goes back to consumer confidence. It all goes back to the confidence someone has in their experience, as well as in their own knowledge in making a decision and being able to make a good decision. So that's the approach that electronics retailer Crutchfield does. So Crutchfield is the kind of organization where if you want to buy a new camera lens or home audio equipment or maybe a new sound system to go into your car, you visit Crutchfield for that. And for their target audience, they go there to really, really research those purchases before they even move forward and putting anything into a shopping cart. So you can see there on the left side of the screen, that's kind of zooming way out on a single product page. It's a really, really long product page with a lot of different content types going on visually as well as verbally. They see pages like that on the site, and when people see them, they read all the way through them. Their target audience loves to do research, loves to compare products side by side. In this case, it's if you're interested in buying a new camera lens and you can see like what it looks like, the types of different pictures it would take and all. And what they've found by looking at site analytics is that when their audience spends a lot of time on a page like that, when they scroll all the way to the bottom, what happens is that they click to read another page just like that. This is an audience that loves to marinate in the details and spend a lot of time getting comfortable with a purchase decision. But it isn't just about being comfortable. It's also about being confident too. Because in a world where media and politicians gaslight us, maybe into believing that we shouldn't trust ourselves, well, smart brands can help us regain confidence in ourselves, as well as in our ability to make good decisions, and in them, and in the strength of our society. And I want to hold on that for a second because, yeah, I want you to tweet the heck out of that and sing it from the rooftops, because this is what organizations owe their users. Any business, any nonprofit, any government institution that's offering a service that wants to have a community that is engaged with it, that wants to keep doing business in that community, needs to respect that community, needs to respect their audience by empowering them to make good decisions. So what organizations owe their users is confidence and empowerment and eventually trust. So education drives empowerment, empowerment drives confidence, and confidence drives trust. And you can call it customer loyalty. That's what's more comfortable in many organizations to sell it internally. But again, this is also about how designers, how copywriters can create a stronger society. So who else cooks up confidence, so to speak? America's Test Kitchen. They're one of my favorite examples. And I loved getting to interview their chief creative officer when I was writing Trustworthy, because the Test Kitchen is an amazing publishing platform. If you're somebody that is a home cook, or if you're somebody that occasionally likes to experiment in the kitchen, they are there for you. They earn attention and love and loyalty because they believe in empowering their audiences by meeting them wherever they are. So whether you are a very savvy home chef or more of a novice that suddenly realizes it's your turn to make dinner and you're on your phone, you're standing in the kitchen, so you're pulling up their Instagram feed, that's fine. You can still find a recipe there on Instagram. And for every step of the recipe, there's an image. And then the instructions are just in the caption for that image. But if you're someone that wants to engage with them on another platform, you can. They publish Cooks Illustrated, Cooks Country, something like a dozen different cookbooks every year. There's an online cooking school. There's the Cooks Illustrated television show. As I said, there's the Instagram feed, and they're active on a number of different other social platforms. They're all about meeting people where they are in terms of their level of expertise, their platform or device, their mindset, the channel. So that means even if you are that more savvy chef and you want to sit down with the magazine and read about the history of salt, you can do that too. They're into that kind of publishing as well. So they're always about optimizing the content type in terms of the length and level of detail to meet the person where they are and to empower them where they are, mentally, socially, and emotionally, platformally. And they engage at that kind of level because their driving ethos isn't about hearing from one famous chef. This is not about ego, but about the science that drives their publishing. They're selling empowerment, not a cult of personality. So that's why they invest in the appropriate level of detail to help you engage your senses in immersive education, whether that's by seeing images of what something should look like or when they tell you what it should sound like and smell like. They're all about empowering people. Jack Bishop, the chief creative officer, when I met with him there, he said that this all goes back to this idea that success breeds confidence. When we help users do well, when we make them feel proud or smart or accomplished, that's when they become more confident in both themselves and in us, in the organization that helped them become more successful. So we know that confident decisions take a certain amount of content. It isn't always, though, about getting more content. One of my favorite examples of that kind of in play is what gov.uk, the British government's website, with their web presence, had to resolve. So it used to be that in the UK, citizens could get government service information from 9 different websites, all published by the government and maintained to various degrees, plus The Guardian, the main newspaper. And in fact, for the official version of information, frequently citizens would turn to the newspaper over government websites because they weren't consistent and they were incredibly painful to kind of weed through, and people never knew if they were getting like the most recent and up-to-date information. The problem was also a lot around content proliferation. The government published content on a lot of different topics. So for example, if you were interested in beekeeping in Britain, you could turn to the government on one of those 9 different websites and find out information about what species of bees did best in different parts of Britain, how to build a beehive, how to maintain it through different seasons, as well as information on how to pay the VAT, how to pay the tax on importing bees into Britain. But most of that information, it should really have been coming from an agricultural website. The government didn't need to be telling you that much about bees. They did need to tell you about the tax information, though. So they adopted a mindset that elevated that kind of content. They adopted sort of a mantra that said, government should only be offering content. Government should only be publishing content on the things that only government can publish content. If someone else can talk about the other stuff, let's let them. So by adopting that mindset of saying, let's pare this down to just what we should be doing and focus on maintaining that, they went through a big content auditing process. Previously, they had maintained 75,000 pages of content across those 9 sites. When they went through that process of auditing the content and pulling it back and editing it down to the essentials, it brought it down to just 3,000 pages. And then in the content design for those pages themselves, in the information design for those pages, they stripped away the unnecessary stuff. They stripped away the ancillary information that said, you know, you may also be interested in these related topics. Because it turns out when people are turning to government, they're not interested in browsing related topics. They're there to do a job. They're there to complete a transaction and get it done and know that they've done enough. And that sense of enough is a really hard thing to telegraph through design. It's a really hard thing to communicate, but they did a wonderful job in doing it by stripping away any kind of ancillary content from the page and adding one additional signifier that says, this is official. It's that crown up in the corner. Previously, their sites didn't have that crown, so you couldn't really be sure that it was indeed a government-endorsed site. They learned that through user feedback because people were kind of poking around, accomplishing tasks, and then saying, well, is that all I have to do? I mean, I got done what you needed me to do, but I don't know if that was enough, if it was right. They tested out adding in that crown as well, adding in that additional seal of approval. And it turned out people felt like, oh, well, that was the official version. I did what I needed to do, and now I'm done. So you know you have enough content when your audience can make decisions and then feel confident that they made the right decisions. So yes, this is a call for content design and information design to determine the right content types and the right point of view in creative direction. This is work, but this is the work that best serves our audiences and best empowers our audiences, that helps to drive their sense of confidence in what we offer them and in their own interactions with it. So now I want to talk a bit about vulnerability, that third part of the framework. So individually, a consistent voice, the appropriate volume of information, those are really characteristics of any kind of good brand-driven content strategy or design effort. But it's through vulnerability that we unite those efforts in voice and volume to foster trust. So vulnerability is the risk that we take for connection. And again, we should not mistake it for weakness, because the smartest brands grow stronger by owning their mistakes and embracing vulnerability, or by making their values visible and accepting all that may come with that. They open themselves to criticism and ridicule and rabid customers sometimes by revealing hard truths or confronting challenges. But it's by confronting those challenges in public, by saying this is who we are and this is what we need to work on, that they draw their audiences closer to build a more engaged community and more loyal brand champions. So as I said, vulnerability, that is the risk that we take on for connection, but it's also it's kind of an important thing for any modern and maturing brand. Because when we talk about authenticity, I mean, that's a buzzword that gets thrown around a lot, but it's vulnerability that is the cost of authenticity. It's also the cost of transparency. When we want to show people who we are, when we want to expose them to how our actions align with our values, that's what we're talking about when we talk about authenticity. Those terms have real meanings if our clients are brave enough to embrace them, if the organizations that we support are brave enough to embrace them. So I want to take a look at a couple of examples of that in action. You might be familiar with the spice retailer Penzies. They're a spice retailer based in the upper Midwest. They're one of the largest chains of spice retailers in the US. And they really put a stake in the ground around their values. They make their values visible. They put themselves out there, I guess, so to speak. And when you're a company and you put yourself out there, that's how you find your community. So in the wake of the 2016 election, Bill Penzey, the CEO, he took to Facebook to make clear that the company's positions on immigration and racism didn't align with what he was starting to hear from the presidential candidate and the lead there, who was stoking hatred for immigrants. He felt that ran counter to the company's purpose, which is to bring people together around cooking, cooking as an act of love. I think that's what their bumper stickers say. And for anybody that might have said, hey, stay in your lane there, Spice Boy, he doubled down on that. He really kind of embraced authenticity to say, well, this is our lane. We're a spice retailer. Where do you think we source so many of the things that we sell? It's actually from around the world. And cooking in America is really the story of immigration. So many of our family favorites come here thanks to immigrants. So yeah, cooking is political. What we do is political. And we believe it's important to take a stand here that may not be popular. It may cause us to lose customers, but this is who we are. This is how we are. And you should know that about us if you're thinking about shopping here. Now that is risky. That's vulnerable. And his position drew headlines and criticism. And yeah, the company lost some customers, but then they saw their sales spike to record levels. That happened again and again every time he took to Facebook with that kind of political stance. And over the past few years, Penzies has enjoyed a 50% increase in online sales. As I said, they lost some customers, but they gained so many others. They expanded their target audience because suddenly they weren't just selling spices to people that love to cook. They were also selling spices to people that said, well, I don't cook, but those values align with my values and I'm going to need to buy some Hanukkah presents, some Christmas presents soon for other people in my family. And guess what? This year, they're going to be getting spices. So people were ordering from them for gifts and because they wanted to support the company and its perspectives. In contrast, Penzies' closest competitor, the Spice House, in the wild world of spice retailers, they took a different approach. They said, business should stay out of politics. Here's our discount code, no politics. We're going to stay out of all of that. But we know that staying out of politics is a stance that reflects privilege that is not always shared by the people who are most affected by discriminatory policies. And we've seen how again and again, when organizations put a stake in the ground and say, this is how we feel about a particular social issue, we see how that's how they find their audience. That's also how they let their community find them. When they say, this is what's important to us, it allows their audience then to make different, maybe better shopping decisions. So we can see that vulnerability like voice, that's an act that tells people who you are and it empowers them with information so that they can make more informed decisions about where they want to do business. And yes, it's risky for a brand to put a stake in the ground, but maybe it takes even more vulnerability when they're not looking at voicing their values, but rather acknowledging deficiencies and asking for help. maybe your company has screwed up and employees and critics and customers are now demanding explanations and accountability. Your organization is at its most vulnerable when you're staggering away from mistakes. Maybe you put a stake in the ground around a particular social issue, an external issue, only to realize that it's an issue internally as well. Well, what happens next is what matters most. Do you double down on defeat, hope to kind of sweep the issue away and hope that the next news cycle moves on? Or do you embrace the opportunity to acknowledge what happened and hopefully to earn an even greater degree of trust? I know this is kind of meta since we're on Zoom, but I want to talk about Zoom in that light, because in the past year, they've offered us a masterclass in vulnerability. So in December of 2019, Zoom had about 10 million daily meeting participants. Most of them were business customers, most of whom had IT departments with security protocols. By last March, as the virus had reached pandemic proportions, those 10 million daily users jumped to more than 200 million daily users. Because businesses were responding to COVID-19 by mandating that people work from home, schools also embraced remote learning. Some 90,000 schools across 20 different countries jumped on the platform, and then everybody was having birthday celebrations and happy hours on Zoom. And by everybody, I mean friends and preschool teachers and book clubs, and more people than ever before wanted the platform to operate in ways in which it had not been designed, and often without the guidance of an IT department who might have said things like, hey, you might want to set a password to ensure only the people you invite can attend, or enable a waiting room to screen your attendees. But that didn't happen. So enter the Zoom bombers. And the CEO, Eric Yuan, as he saw this problem kind of popping up everywhere, he could have called out those issues. He could have said, hey, you're using it wrong. Think about setting up some security around this. He could have stoked their anger. He could have called people to kind of blame the Zoom bombers, but he didn't do any of that. Instead, in early April of last year, he wrote a blog post that is a model of building trust through vulnerability. So first, he spoke in a humble but confident voice and with a volume of detail that respected his users, and then with vulnerability to also bring them into the process and say, here's what happened. Here's what we're going to do about it. Here's what you can expect from us. Here's how you can hold us accountable. So he started out by apologizing in the first person. And then from there, he moved on to speak more broadly about what happened. And he offered credit then to his team and what they would be doing, kind of moving from I to we. He pivoted from making a you're using it wrong kind of problem into an opportunity to say, yes, here's what happened. Thanks for calling it out. Here's what we're going to do about it. He credits the community. And then he offers a plan to hold him accountable for a resolution. He went on to say, we're going to be enacting a feature freeze and shifting all of our engineering resources to focus on trust and safety issues. The following week, Zoom made those virtual waiting rooms and meeting passwords the default on all new meetings. Then he detailed how he'd be conducting weekly webinars and publishing a transparency report and submitting to third-party audits. So his response was swift, it was specific, it was transparent, and that makes it a powerful case study in how you can earn trust even while confronting trouble. At such a point of vulnerability, he engaged with enough confidence to respect his audience and help foster their confidence in the platform itself. So voice and volume and vulnerability, they add up to empower people to renew their confidence and rebuild their sense of trust. And as we stumble back from a few years of gaslighting and cynicism, that's what people need more than anything right now. That's what our society needs. And we've lost trust in institutions, but smart organizations, many businesses can step into that void, because regardless of your industry, I believe that your brand can be a leader in moving all of us forward. Because yes, it is easy to be cynical, and we have so many reasons to be cynical. But cynics look at the world as it is and say, it's worse. I think designers and writers and builders of brands and brainstorms, we look at the world as it is and say, it can be better, so let's work so that it will be. And if you are hopeful that it can be, let's do the work so that it will be. Because despite all of those reasons to be cynical, people do still act with hope. we'll scroll a little bit longer, click around a little bit further, watch one more video, because we think we'll become that much smarter and better and kinder. Right now is a time to affirm that hope. So let's design our way out of cynicism and toward trust. And I think that's something that we need to do, that you need to do for yourself, your organization, for your users, and for our society. Thank you very, very much. And if you are fired up, if you are as bullish about this as I am, and I do believe that this is our best path forward, these are what we can do. These are the things we can do to move our society forward. So yes, go get the book, review the book, because yes, your reviews on Amazon do make such a huge difference to authors. And if you're in the Bay Area, you can order it from Booksmith. I believe the link is in the chat. They will give you free local shipping. And I did talk with them. They say, yes, on the website, it says out of stock, but that's only because they're shipping it from the warehouse instead of directly from the store. The other thing I wanted to say is if you order it, email me your receipt and I will send you a signed custom book plate. So thank you very, very much. And yeah, let's get to work.
Thank you so much, Margot. That was beautiful and relevant and timely and useful. I really appreciate all your timely examples. We have a couple questions in the Q&A. If you have a question for Margot, please use the Q&A feature. I really appreciate hearing from you how we creators, educators can have a hand and a heart in creating trust. Mm-hmm. So Trustworthy is your second book. I wonder if you could talk about the process of writing the book, designing the cover, the illustration, using your trademark Benton modern typeface. And also I wanted to talk about this, especially because we are joined tonight by your developmental editor, Jill Swenson. Hi, Jill.
Yes, definitely. Hi, Jill. So I guess, yeah, where do you want me to start? Like the process around the book or the cover, or where do we start? At the beginning? It's a very good place to start.
Yeah. Let's start with the zygote of the idea. Like you had finished content strategy at work. There were a couple of years went by. What was the zygote of like, this is going to be a completely relevant and timely topic in the next couple of years when I'm done with it?
Yeah. So I think that what I saw happening, probably going back to like 2015, 2016 in the political arena, that was kind of the thing that that was driving me to think not so much about a book, but about wanting to dig into this topic, because I was seeing how, you know, it used to be if we caught a politician in a lie, it would scuttle their campaign. The media would hold him, and it was usually him, to task for it. And that wasn't happening. We were seeing how politicians on both sides of the aisle were rewriting their records, but also how Trump especially was changing his stance on so many things. And what bothered me wasn't that he was changing, but that it didn't seem to matter to his audience. And that gets into lots of issues around how people make decisions and how they shift their decisions, how they shift their loyalties. And a lot of that goes back to this idea of cultural identity. If you thought of yourself as a Trump supporter, didn't matter what Trump did, you still thought of yourself the same way. And so many of our decisions are tied up in that sense of self. So if we want to affect the way people think, if we want to engage them with information, help them engage with information as marketers, we need to get at that idea of self in a really kind of concrete way. But also, as I saw what was happening in the political arena, I wanted to see, well, was this going to be relevant for my clients? Because that's not my world. I work with retailers and startups and a lot of consumer brands. And I wondered how much it was going to affect their work and their kind of engagement with audiences. So as I was digging in there and wondering, well, is this going to be a bigger deal? Is this going to be relevant? It quickly became a bigger deal and much more relevant. And then I was talking with a lot of audiences. I think I started researching and speaking about this topic in, as I said, I think 2015 or 2016. I think I spoke about it in 2017 at South by Southwest. And then in a lot of other conference contexts where I might've had like 100 people or a couple hundred people in the audience, like the people that could afford to be at that conference. But I wanted a way to get these ideas, to get this thinking, to get the framework that I have in the book around what to do about these problems, I wanted a way to get them to more people. And a book is a great way to make your ideas portable, to help them become more viral. And that's what I wanted most. I wanted more people to kind of wrangle with this issue and look at how they could affect change through their own work, whether it was a CMO or a designer or a creative director or the person that's running the social media account. I wanted more people to kind of embrace this problem and know what to do about it in ways that were concrete and actionable. So that's what led then to a book.
And so what was the process like working with Jill?
I was about to say wonderful, but at times it was painful because that's what it took to get to wonderful. she made me cry, and that's why at times I was also able to like really celebrate. Yes, ruthless and unforgiving. There was some forgiveness in there, I think. I think a lot of my ideas, a lot of like my research started in interviewing brands that I thought were doing things right, that were figuring out how to establish rapport, how to establish trust with their audiences. And then I learned a lot from those organizations. And I interviewed people at, you heard me say, like MailChimp and America's Test Kitchen and gov.uk, also the National Health Service in Britain. And then in the States at the FBI and local elections bureaus. And then like some of like the early people that had established like Banana Republic before it was acquired by The Gap, but had a really unique singular voice that was well known and well trusted by their audience. And I wanted to know in all of those cases, if we took it apart, well, what could we learn from it? What could the people that were my readers, what could they learn from it eventually? And were there any common themes and patterns? And I think when I first started working on the book, it was more or less that collection of stories because I hadn't yet figured out, like, were there some overriding themes? Were there some patterns? Was there a framework from which we could learn? And I remember having a discussion with you kind of early on in that process where I was kind of bemoaning that I didn't yet have like a publisher for it. I didn't yet know kind of how to frame those ideas. And I think you said, "Do you know Jill Swenson?" And it was in the tone of voice that you used when you said to me about so many people like, "Oh, do you know this person?" And I'm like, how would I know that person? You know, they're like this very famous person or this very like niche person that I'm like, I don't know that person, but I want to know them because it would definitely improve my Trivial Pursuit game if I knew that person. But yeah, you introduced me to Jill and that definitely changed and shaped the direction of the book and the direction and shape of my thinking too. Because I think Jill was the first person that said to me like, yes, even though it's nonfiction, you need a narrative arc. People still need that. They need to know kind of how you're pulling them through, which was very helpful advice. But I think also when I look back over so much of my work as a designer and as a content strategist and as a writer, I think I have oftentimes been afraid of ever writing a conclusion or creating something that feels like a conclusion to the user. And Jill helped me reckon with that. So I think for the first time in like 30 plus years, I finally wrote conclusions. Because I think before that, through design and through content, I've always been happy sort of like presenting the evidence and then assuming like, okay, my audience gets it. I'm not going to belabor the point anymore. QED, let's move on to the next thing. And she helped me kind of reckon with that those things that we think are obvious because we're so embroiled in the work are not necessarily obvious to everyone. And by making them obvious, that's what makes them actionable to our readers, to our users. When we're designing an interface or designing a poster, sometimes we have to kind of leave things in suspense, let people connect the dots because that can be so incredibly rewarding to them. We're showing a form of respect to the audience by letting them connect the dots. But in other cases, we have to clarify that this is where the dots go. This is the conclusion at which you need to arrive so that they can take action on it. And striking that balance as a designer and as a writer has been, I think, a lifelong learning experience for me. And continues to be.
I really appreciate that metaphor of like how many dots are connected versus giving 100% of the details to the reader. Mm-hmm. So let's shift to some of the questions that the participants have supplied. Thank you, participants. Kristen asks, she says, excellent presentation, agreed. To what extent do you believe that cynicism on the part of the user is a healthy response and should be encouraged? How would you identify the threshold?
I think skepticism is a healthy response of not always approaching everything with wide-eyed innocence, willing to believe everything that is offered to you. I think that can be a dangerous path because not all people that communicate with us are good actors operating in good faith. But I think skepticism teaches us to, it comes from a point of confidence of saying, I don't believe everything. Let me continue to do the research, become a smarter consumer of information, become smarter about my own health, become smarter about where I choose to consume information. Skepticism says, let me continue doing the research to come to my own conclusions, to come to conclusions where I feel confident and good. I think cynicism does not take us down that path of being open to new information. When we're cynical, we wall ourselves off from new information. We say, well, everybody lies. They're all out to get you. I can't possibly learn anything new on this subject. The conversation is over. And that's a dangerous point because when we say the conversation is over, when we put up those walls, whether it's between, you know, us and a friend or colleague, or when we put up those walls between organizations that are trying to help us or give us information, then there's no hope for progress on either side. We end up in this sort of like static state in which we've abandoned growth. And that's not healthy. As I said, I think that it can sometimes be a natural response to the world where we say, whew, I'm done for the day. But hopefully most of us come back then the next day and say, okay, I'm ready to re-engage. Let me learn more and keep gathering information.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so Jack said, you said that we need to empower our listeners and give them confidence to trust themselves to make decisions. What if they already feel empowered and confident and trust their own points of view, but our goal is to help shift those points of view?
I think that's a really good question. I think when people are already really kind of fixed in their ideas, but we need to kind of shift their ideas. We need to kind of meet them again where they are, like find out why they hold those ideas. And I see this conversation a lot among vaccine skeptics, among people that, you know, are maybe self-described anti-vaxxers, where they may be really entrenched in their beliefs, maybe for really good reasons, maybe because they feel like, you know, their experience previously with commercialized healthcare hasn't been so positive. They've had maybe negative reactions to vaccines in the past. And maybe that is due to causation, or maybe it's due to correlation. I think whatever those reasons are, when we talk down to people, or it turns out even when we hit them over the head with like one more snarky meme on Facebook, who knew, but they don't actually shift their beliefs. Turns out what does work to help people that are really set in their beliefs is by getting in there with them and being compassionate for their perspectives, figuring out why and having that open dialogue. A recent study demonstrated that when we're trying to kind of shift the needle, so to speak, on vaccines, on public vaccination, the best way to do that isn't by hitting people over the head with more information, but rather by arming their maybe holistic medicine practitioners or the physicians or medical folks that they already trust with information to have a better conversation, a more vulnerable conversation, where they're also maybe sharing their own uncertainties and sharing in kind of their path to shifting their beliefs. I heard someone on NPR recently, it was a physician in the Boston area, where she was talking about how, yeah, when the coronavirus vaccine first rolled out, she was kind of uncertain about it. She was worried that it had been rushed. And she said, yeah, I was really worried that it had been rushed. So I kept doing my research. So she was, to go back to the previous question, she was skeptical, but open to doing research. And as a medical professional, she has access to information as well as an ability to understand information that lay people may not have. So it was great to hear her talk about this. She said, I kept doing the research. And as I kind of read more about the studies and kind of clinical trials and all, I realized it wasn't that the vaccine had been rushed. The funding for it had been rushed. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. Maybe in the future, like more funding for public health efforts should be allocated quickly. So I kept doing my research. As I learned more, my perspective shifted. And then I realized I do trust this new vaccine because now I understand how it was developed, how it was funded. I feel comfortable taking it. I feel comfortable recommending it to my patients now. And I think it was probably like a 30-second clip, but in having that open dialogue where she shared her personal evolution in such a vulnerable way, it really helped to shift a lot of mindsets, I think, in her audience.
I love this discussion. I think we could keep talking for hours. I think we're going to do two more questions. Mary asks, do you think that being vulnerable becomes more difficult with bigger brand?
I think I wouldn't say bigger brands have a greater challenge around vulnerability because in large organizations, if they're able to codify it, to establish new guidelines around what vulnerability looks like and sounds like, maybe speaking in the first person, leading with accountability, well, they can shift an entire organization by making that kind of policy change. I think the bigger issue that I see is in older organizations where there's a culture that has evolved maybe through like the 1980s. Like the comparison that I always use is that was an era when everybody wore shoulder pads to seem sort of like bigger than they were and tougher than they were. And businesses also wore shoulder pads, so to speak, to seem bigger than they were. There was a lot of bravado in advertising. And you certainly never wanted a competitor to know kind of any challenges that were going on there. You'd never want to tell your audience kind of maybe issues that you were contending with in developing a new product. And it's tough, I think, for businesses that kind of matured and evolved through the 1980s to now adopt a mindset, to adopt a shift in tone that says, well, what happens if we kind of break that fourth wall and bring people more into our development process? Maybe if we try to prototype in public and say, this is a new feature that we're looking to roll out, what do you think? And you see though how newer organizations, certainly organizations that have launched like through Kickstarter that are so used to speaking in the first person and offering constant updates to their backers, they're much more positioned through their communication style to bring people in and say, here's what we're trying to decide. What do you think? And kind of shifting to that tone is foreign and fearsome to so many more entrenched organizations. And that's, I think, where I see the difference.
I really like the idea of prototyping in public. You mentioned it in the book that there is a way to break down the fourth wall, the proverbial us versus them. How do you think the designers of the future could be more radically inclusive?
I think by sharing directly with your target audiences. Maybe it's not in the context of bringing people into the lab or in a focus group. One of the examples that I share is from BuzzFeed. When they've rolled out different features, whether it was around like the style of maps and how they present information on their site, or when they've rolled out new features around bringing in content from outside sources and from other publishers and other platforms, they do a lot of kind of A/B testing side by side on their site to say, this is something new we're trying. What do you think? And gosh, like having a box that says, what do you think, open on your website, that's basically like it's Halloween, you've left the light on your front porch and you're saying, free candy, everybody, just come on into my kitchen. And who knows what's gonna happen in your kitchen then. But as a result, for their target audience, they've gained a lot of respect. They're no longer like the land of listicles and top 10 lists and whatnot. They've kind of left that back to the era of David Letterman. And yeah, I mean, top 10 lists are really the province of David Letterman and God, and BuzzFeed is neither of those brands. But this idea of saying, tell us what you think, that shows a tremendous level of confidence that people aren't going to come in and kind of take all the Reese's peanut butter cups. But also it shows a tremendous amount of respect for your audience. People here, like, you want to know my opinion? I'll tell you, that font is way too small on my browser. And I think that level of respect, if a brand wants to gain respect, they have to give respect first. Mm-hmm. And some organizations get that better than others.
Well, that's a lovely note to end on. If the rest of the team, Kimberly, Nina, Helen, Maria are still here, let's turn on our videos. And thank you so much for being here again, Margot. It's such a pleasure to be together. I know that everyone here tonight really appreciated your talk. And thank you all for being here. Thank you, team. That concludes our Distributed Design Lecture Series.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good night. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Margot. It was awesome.